Last week, police in Washington state made an arrest in the 30-year-old killing of a Canadian couple.
She had been sexually assaulted and shot in the back of the head. He had been beaten and strangled.
There was plenty of DNA evidence, but nobody really to point a finger at.
For 31 years, there was basically no resolution. But then the power of using genetics and genealogy was able to get the name of a suspect within a day. Because of the sort of analysis we can now do, you can discover things about the relatives of people who have uploaded their genetic information to the internet. And I think that's what's both the power of this method and also the thing that raises a lot of these disquieting questions about privacy and consent that we're going through right now.
We're evolving how DNA shows who you're connected to.
Genetics is this thing that we think of as cutting-edge science. You know, it's happening in some of the most advanced labs in the world. And genealogy is something that, you know, maybe makes you think of your grandparents, you know, looking up records, maybe going to churches and looking at gravestones to kind of try and trace your family tree back. So genetic genealogy is what happens when you combine those two sciences.
A family tree represents so much more than history.
So in the mid-2000s, this new industry started to grow based on the rise of a consumer DNA testing industry. And that was something that came out of the sequencing of the human genome, basically companies trying to figure out how to make this a consumer product.
I decided to have my DNA tested through Ancestry DNA. The big surprise was we're not German at all.
Family Tree DNA was the first company on the scene. They were really targeting hardcore genealogists. And then you have companies that are more targeted at a broader commercial audience start coming into the scene. Now, GEDmatch really was an important breakthrough in genetic genealogy because what it did was it created an open source site where if you had done Ancestry's DNA test, you could also compare your results to people who had done other DNA tests. But, you know, my DNA isn't just my DNA. It's my cousin's DNA. It's my mom's DNA. And so when I make a decision to share my DNA, I'm also making a decision to share their DNA.
So at this point, at least 30 million people have taken these consumer DNA tests. Some large portion of those people have also uploaded the results to these public databases that are searchable by anyone who's curious.
30 million might not seem like a big number to you. Of course, you know, there's billions of people in the world, but the reason that number is significant is that you don't necessarily have to have shared your genetic information in order for your information to be exposed. So there was one study that found that just 2% of people in the world would need to share their genetic information for us to potentially be able to identify everybody.
I'm joined right now with genetic genealogist, that's a mouthful right there, CC Moore. Hi, how are you?
It's great to meet you. Yeah. I'm happy to be here.
So CC Moore is probably one of the most interesting people that I have ever interviewed. She started off her career as a model, actress. At one point, she made a living playing Barbie. And at one point, she decided that she wanted to make a family tree as a gift for her niece who was getting married.
This sort of became this pretty all-consuming pastime for her, and she didn't have, you know, formal scientific training. It's just that she was doing a lot of this, and through sort of trial and error, she realized the way that you could merge these traditional genealogical methods with the genetic information and also social media.
She came up with this idea of triangulating your relatives to discover the hidden identity of someone. And then she became the genetic genealogist on this TV show called Finding Your Roots.
So take a look at this family tree.
Mm-hmm.
This is Christian Kummel and Teresa Stockhausen.
Mm-hmm.
We traced another of their descendants and found one of their great-grandsons who was willing to test for us.
So as Cece Moore is helping all these adoptees find their birth parents, people begin asking the question of what else can we use this technique for? And there's one really obvious answer to what else you can use that for, and that is figuring out who committed a crime.
June 18th, 1976 marked the first known rape by the East Area Rapist.
The Golden State Killer was this serial murderer rapist who terrorized California in the 70s. There was plenty of DNA evidence, but nobody really to point a finger at. So it became a cold case.
And then in the spring of 2018, there was this announcement of the solving of this decades-old case that had used these methods to basically identify the suspect.
Cece Moore sees this as a green light. She gets in contact with this company called Parabon, which can take really degraded DNA samples and extract information out of them and make the same sort of genetic profile, the same kind of file that you would get from a 23andMe or an Ancestry. She had already been in contact with a few police departments and detectives across the country, including detectives in Snohomish County, Washington, where there had been a very brutal murder.
21-year-old Jay Cook and 18-year-old Tanya Van Kylenborg were murdered while visiting Seattle from Victoria, British Columbia.
There were a few clues. There was this blue blanket that one of the bodies had been wrapped in, and there was DNA. And 1987 happens to be the very dawn of the DNA analysis era in law enforcement.
But there are really severe limitations to that. It's really more of a confirmation tool than like a true detective tool.
And even as these databases grew, there weren't any matches.
This should tell us which ones we can be more confident about.
Cece gets to work doing her part, which is trying to figure out what kinds of records and stuff you can use to build out this family tree. Not every crime scene DNA sample will have a relative that has uploaded their genetic information. So you kind of have to win the lottery. And Cece won big. She didn't just get one match, she got two.
So basically, whoever gave that sample, the suspect, has two relatives in the GEDmatch database, and they're pretty good matches in the context of genetic genealogy. They're second cousins.
And when she built out the family trees, there was only one male that was the right amount of relatedness to the genetic hits in GEDmatch. And they knew from other evidence that they were looking for a male. So it was very strong indication very quickly of who their suspect might be.
The suspect happened to be a truck driver, so they followed him around in his truck for a few days, and at one point, a coffee cup falls out of the truck when he's pulling away from a traffic light, and they are able to test the saliva on the lip of the coffee cup, and it matches.
Yesterday, we took into custody a 55-year-old SeaTac man who is suspected of the 1987 murders of Jay Cook and Tanya Van Kylenborg.
We, the jury, find the defendant, William Earl Talbot II, guilty of the crime of first-degree murder as charged in conduct.
It's an incredible testament to the power of these tools. Given the right kind of data, someone with Cece's abilities is able to sift through an enormously large data set and come back with a single name.
So to go from entertainment and then end up in a science career in my 40s is definitely not something I would have ever imagined.
Without genetic genealogy, this case never would have been solved. Cece Moore did in 2 hours what 20 or 30 cops couldn't do in 30 years.
I think most people don't realize the power of these types of tests.
when this happened, there was sort of this agreement, okay, we can use this very powerful technology to solve cold cases. But very quickly, people started to use the technology for other things, for murders that were not long unsolved. And I think when that happened, that started to raise the level of discomfort people had. The particularly sticky thing here is that you're not just sharing your information, you're sharing your family's information. And that's a tough thing, especially when we know things like the criminal justice system disproportionately targets minorities, right? Or when we know that sometimes DNA evidence is wrong.
And I think another part of the cautionary aspect of this is that this is an application of genetic analysis that nobody dreamed of when we set out to sequence the human genome. And it's only through this combination of these obsessive people with their weird interests discovering this tool that we have ended up here. And so I think there's bound to be other totally unforeseen uses for this that we can't even imagine right now.
Somebody might find out, you know, about your family health history, for example. A life insurer, if they knew that you were prone to heart attacks, they would be able to use that information to deny you a policy. So it's not just, you know, crime suspects that face exposure with this information. All of us could be exposed in one way or another once this information is out there.
It's an enormously rich data trove that a lot of people have decided to make public. And perhaps the people who've uploaded it haven't fully thought through the implications.